The Gospel according to St. John, chapter 8, verse 58. We've been using this as a series for a few weeks, and we've been meditating on this particular series. And the title of the series is, I Am That I Am. That particular verse says in John, chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Yeshu ne unhone kaha, main tumse sach sach kehta hu, Abraham ke जन्म लेने के पहले से ही मैं हूँ. Jesus Christ said, I am that I am. இருக்கிறவராக இருக்கிறேன். The Lord said that my name is I am that I am. When you go back and look at the Old Testament, when the Lord God wanted to set his people free, wanted to bring them out of all their slavery in Egypt to bring them back into the promised land, the Lord wanted to reveal himself to his people. As Moses was asking the Lord, Lord, what is your name? Because it's been 400 years, we have not known any other God other than the gods of Egypt. But I am seeing this different God right now, a God who is in the burning bush, as I see that it is ablaze with fire, but it is not burnt up, it is not consumed. Who are you, God? What is your name? How shall I introduce your name to the people of Israel? And the Lord said, I am that I am. My name is I am. Go and tell the people of Israel that I am that I am. The God I am has sent me to you. I am the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. And that was his name, I am that I am, because he's not a God of the past. He's not a God who's dead and gone. He's a God who was, who is, and who is to come. That is why he said, I am that I am. And several years later, as Jesus Christ came into this world, he wanted to connect his identity with that I am God. He said that the same God who was with Abraham, the same God who was with Jacob, the same God who was with Isaac, the same God who said, I am that God. I have come into this world as the I am God. That was his introduction. Throughout the Gospel of the book of John, we see seven different places where Jesus Christ introduced himself as revelations about who he really was. As the world was looking, as the people of Israel were confused about the identity of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, in many different clear signs, revealed himself as the Messiah that they were waiting for. And he was talking to them about how he was the I am God. So in the last 4 weeks, we've been meditating about that. And every week that we've been meditating about one particular name or the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Sansar ki jyoti main hu. Naan ulagathirku oliya irukiren. That was the first one that we meditated upon. I am the light of the world. Sansar ki jyoti main hu. The second week, we meditated from John's Gospel chapter 10, verse 9, where Jesus said, I am the door. I am the door for the sheep. Jesus said, Nane vasal endru Yesu thanne kurithu velipaduthinar. Main tumse sach sach kehta hu, bedon ka dwar main hu. Bedon ka dwar main hu. Naan aadugalukku vasal, I am the gate for the sheep. That is how Jesus revealed himself as the only way to enter into the eternity. Through him only we can have salvation. He revealed as a sign that he is the Messiah through whom only we can have the salvation. The third week, we meditated from John's Gospel chapter 14, verse 6, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Marg, or Satya, or Jeevan, Mehi hu. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nane valiyum satyamum jeevanum ayirukkiren. That is what we meditated upon the third week. And the fourth week, we meditated last week from John's Gospel chapter 10, verse 11, where Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Acha charvaha mehu. Nane nalla meipan. Acha charvaha mehu. Those were the four things that we meditated about the Lord Jesus Christ as he revealed who he was through these I am statements. And now for the fifth week, we are going to meditate from the John's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 35. The title of today's meditation is, I am the bread of life. John 6:35, Jesus said, And the word of God says, and Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. And he who believes in me shall never thirst. उन्होंने उत्तर दिया, जीवन की रोटी मैं हूँ, जो मेरे पास आता है उसे कभी भूख नहीं लगती, और जो मुझे में विश्वास करता है उसे कभी प्यास नहीं लगेगी. ஏசு அவர்களை நோக்கி, ஜீவ அப்பம் நானே, என்னிடத்தில் வருகிறவன் ஒரு காலம் பசியடையான், என்னிடத்தில் விசுவாசமாக இருக்கிறவன் ஒரு காலம் தாகமடையான். That was the statement that Jesus made about who he was, about his identity. I am the bread of life. Jesus repeats the same statement again in the same chapter. John's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 48, he said, I am the bread of life. When we understand that Jesus was very contextual in all his revelations, in the Gospel according to St. John, when we see the very first sign that Jesus gave about himself was in the wedding house of Cana of Galilee, where Jesus was invited to a wedding where he revealed himself as how he was going to shed his blood for the people, as he blessed 6 jars of water to be transformed into wine. That was a sign for the people to realize that there is remission of sin through this Messiah who's come into the world. And Jesus wanted his identity to be known by that sign. By converting the water into the wine, he said that he was the one who could forgive the sins of the mankind by shedding his own blood, because the Bible says there is no remission of sins without shedding of blood. Like that, in every single occasion that Jesus had in the Gospel of St. John, it was always a sign of pointing to how Jesus was the only Messiah. When we see about the entire book of Gospel, the Gospel of John, we can understand that it always points to one thing. It is about salvation. It always proclaims one thing about eternal life. It always was very clear that it is only through Jesus Christ that one can receive that salvation and come to have that eternal life. You may be listening to me from many different convictions, many different backgrounds, or many different belief systems. But the Word of God, this Bible is very clear that Jesus Christ is the only way, the truth, and the life. There is no salvation without coming through Jesus Christ. Regardless of how you and I believe, the truth is stated in the Word of God that Jesus Christ is the only way. Now, what was the context for this particular verse that Jesus is talking about, that he is the bread of life? We see in John's Gospel chapter 6, in the beginning when we start to read that chapter, Jesus came upon a mountain and he saw many people, a multitude coming to him. They were all coming to hear Jesus Christ preach and share the gospel of the kingdom. As they were coming, Jesus Christ had compassion upon them. He had so much compassion that he asked his disciples, where can we buy bread that all of these people may eat? But there were a lot of people, thousands of people who were there. And the disciples did not have an answer at all. Philip answered the Lord Jesus Christ, and he said that, where could one go to buy so much bread for all these thousands of people? Just imagine that suddenly there was, you had never planned, 5,000 people showed up at your home. Where are you going to go get food for them? Even if you had supplies in your home for what you need, it's not going to be enough for 5,000 people. Could you go to one shop and buy all the supplies needed for making food for 5,000 people? The question was very genuine, as Philip was saying, how is it possible? Even if he had the money, we cannot buy. Even if he had the, where would we go to buy that? That was the question upon his heart. Jesus did not answer anything to him. Jesus never answers the questions of doubt. He only responds to statements of faith. He never responds to questions of doubt. He responds to statements of faith. Now, there was another disciple who was there with a group of disciples at that time, Andrew. He made a little hopeful statement, yet with some doubt with it. But he made that one statement. He said that there's a little boy here. He has some 5 fish and a few loaves, 5 loaves and a few fish. How is that going to be possible enough for all these people? Jesus did not answer him at all. That was all that he needed, just a little morsel of bread that was available, that was being offered with faith. One person, he said that there's a little boy who has some scope, and this little boy, the Bible does not even record his name. The Bible does not even talk about the transaction that Jesus had with this boy. He just gladly gave what Jesus had. He had 5 loaves and a few little fish. Jesus said, ask all the people to be seated. There was going to be a banquet. Everyone is being seated. There were 5,000 people. Perhaps there were family members there, so there were more than 5,000 people there. All of them were seated. They were all waiting. And Jesus took that bread and a few fish. He blessed and gave it to the disciples and told them, now you go, serve it to the multitude. I don't know what the disciples were thinking at that time. They must have been perturbed in their heart. How is Jesus asking us to take these 5 fish and give it to 5,000 people? But they obeyed. They obeyed exactly what Jesus asked them to do. As they went from one person to the next person to the next person, the disciples saw suddenly there's more fish coming from the basket that they had. They kept on serving. They kept on serving. There was nothing. It never stopped at all. It kept on going all over the place. Everyone received and were full. The Bible says they all ate and they were satisfied. They were satisfied. This was not a psychological miracle. Jesus did not play a trick upon them, that they all felt that they were all satisfied. It's not like that at all. It was a physical miracle. How do we know that? Right after the miracle, Jesus said that, gather all the things that are left over so that you do not waste them. Put them away. And they gathered all the remaining morsels and they found that to be filled with 12 baskets of food. What started with one little basket of a few little fish and 5 loaves. Now, after 5,000 people, more than 5,000 people have eaten. Now they were able to fill that with 12 basketfuls. Hallelujah to the Lord. This evening, that same Jesus Christ, the miracle worker, is among us. He says that no shortage is a problem for him. He is able to take care of all our needs, and he is able to supply all our needs to the full without we having to worry about that at all. So Jesus did this wonderful miracle. Everyone was so happy. But something happened after that. They decided to say, okay, this is the kind of king that we want. Why don't we catch him and take him and make him to be the king of Israel? They all started to think, it's been a long time since we had a king who was able to bless Israel. When Solomon was the king, everyone had everything full. David was the king. The nation was fertile, was blessed. When Moses was the captain, everyone had all their fill. No one was having anything and lacking for 40 long years as they were even walking through the wilderness. And now we have a magician among us. We have a magic worker among us. He can make food anytime we want. We don't have to be under the Romans at all. We don't have to be worried waiting for their resources. We can just have our own king who can do magic, can create all the food for us. So they decided to take Jesus and make him king. Jesus knew that and departed from them. They did not know where Jesus went. The Bible says he went back up on the mountaintop, continued to pray for the nation, because he must have been praying, Father, these people are not able to recognize my sign. I did this big, big miracle because I wanted them to know you. I wanted them to come to you because you sent me as the bread into this world. But they have not realized that. He must have been praying that night. The disciples got on a boat. They wanted to cross the Sea of Galilee, or the Sea of Tiberias, as it's called. It's the same sea. It's called the same thing. It's not really a sea. It is actually a lake, a large lake that you can see. Boats go upon that lake. It is such a large lake. And they decided to get on the boat and go on the other side. Only the disciples were there. All the people saw the disciples were on the boat. They left to go to the other side. But they looked for Jesus. Jesus was not in the boat when they left. But Jesus, at the middle of the night, he walked up on the water to come to the people, come to the disciples while they were still rowing their boat to go to the other side. When he got into the boat, we all know that story, how the boat reached the other shore. Immediately they came to Capernaum, which was on the other side of Galilee. It is a place where Peter had his home, so he came to Capernaum. The people came next day morning. They were looking for Jesus. They were seeing, where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? And they said that, well, there's only one way. He must have gone to the other side. But how did he go? We don't know. They got onto other boats and they crossed the lake as well to come to Capernaum. When they saw Jesus Christ on the other side, they couldn't believe. They said, how did you come here? Well, we thought only your disciples came. And then they had a discourse, they had a conversation where Jesus was trying to be more explicit about his identity to the people who came seeking for him. And that is exactly when he spoke these particular words. He said that I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. In John's Gospel chapter 6 verse 26 and 27, that is when Jesus started to talk to them. He said that Jesus said to them, assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. You ate of the loaves and you were filled. That's the only reason you are coming here. That is the human tendency. Many times we just want some food. That's it. Wherever there's food, people will go. You're human now. It is true everywhere. As I was working for a company, we used to go to interview candidates in colleges. And all the recruiting people would say, if you get pizza, all the students will come. That's what they will say. So they'll get pizza, free pizza for everyone and say, free pizza. And then they have this talk show kind of thing. Then everyone will come. People just go. Where there is food available, they'll just go. That's exactly what they all came for. Jesus said that you came not because you saw the signs. Jesus did not use the word miracle there. He said that you came not because you saw the signs. There was a sign that I am the Messiah, but you didn't come seeking me because you understood the sign and you came to me as a Messiah. But you came because you ate the loaves and were full. And Jesus told them, don't just work for the food for this world. Don't do that. But do the works that are worthy of eternity. Worthy of eternity. You got to just pause and think about the statement that Jesus made. Don't just keep on working for this life. Don't keep on working only for what you need in this life. This is only a short time. But you have an eternity to come. You got to work towards that eternity. You got to do something to mind your eternity, not for only this life. And they said that, what must we do? What must we do this work of eternity you are talking about, this eternal life to go there? What do we need to do? Jesus said one simple statement. The only thing you need to do is to believe in the name of the Lord, of the Son who God has sent. நீங்கள் அவரை விசுவாசிப்பதே நித்திய ஜீவனுக்கு ஏற்ற கிரியையாக இருக்கிறது. All you had to do is to believe him. And then they started to question him. They said that, well, you are asking us to just believe in you. What kind of a sign do you see that we should believe you that you are from heaven? Moses, you know, he brought for us bread from heaven. You just magically made it appear. It was ordinary bread that we all ate. But Moses didn't give the ordinary bread that you gave us yesterday. Moses gave a special manna that was hidden manna that came from heaven. At that time, Jesus said, I assuredly say to you that Moses did not give you the bread from heaven. It is my Father who gives you the bread from heaven. He was more explicit about how he was the bread that was sent, and not by Moses, but by the Father God. He sent his only begotten Son into this world to die for the sins of this world. To give his own life as a bread that makes one live. Jesus was talking about this parable, saying that he was the bread of life because only with that bread you can live eternally. Just like how the physical food that we eat is allowing us to be alive in this world, to have life in our body. This bread Jesus is talking about. He says, I am the bread of life. He's talking about this eternity. For you and I to go to eternity, we must have this bread. Jesus said, all your fathers ate that manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But he who eats of this bread, he who partakes of this bread, he who comes to me and believes in this bread, he will have life and life eternal. He will not die. Not only that, he will not thirst again. That was the gospel message that Jesus was sharing about himself, how he was the Messiah, how he is the true bread of life. For you and I, that is the greatest assurance that we can have. That this bread, when we have partaken of this bread in our lives, we can live for eternity. We can live for eternity. Now about this bread, I just want to touch upon three different things, aspects of this bread of life, and then we're going to pray and surrender ourselves to the Lord. I do not know where exactly you are in your spiritual walk with the Lord, as those who are watching me from the internet or the live streaming. But one thing I want to encourage you to do today is to allow your heart to receive this message from the Lord Jesus Christ. He said that I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not be hungry. He will not thirst anymore. The very first aspect of the bread, as we think about that and meditate more about that, this bread is food for our body. God cares for our needs. Jesus Christ, when he said that I am the bread of life, he's not someone who just makes outlandish statements and not worry about things that are closer to hand, things that we need to worry about. He always is a practical God. He's a God who always is closer to the reality, closer to the truth, more closer than anything else that we can think of. He's not the only one who says, for eternity, all things will be good. You'll be happy. No. He also blesses us along the way. That is why he blessed the people of Israel. He said that I'm going to take you to the promised land, but I'm going to feed you until you go to the land that flows with milk and honey. He knows exactly how long he had to feed them to cross them over to the promised land. The Bible says when they came to Gilgal, Gilgal was the border land of the nation that God brought them into. On that land, when they ate of the fruit of that nation, when they ate of the wheat from that land, that is when manna stopped. Until then, manna was flowing on. Every day, manna was coming. There was not a single day it stopped. But when they came to Gilgal, when they ate of the fruit of that land, that is when God stopped manna. So he knows exactly how long he has to feed you and feed me in this world. So he is not just making a statement for the eternity. He says, believe me, you will be not hungry at all in eternity. But he also takes care of what we need in this world. John's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 30 and 31, Jesus said, what sign will you perform? Then they asked Jesus. Jesus said, your fathers ate the manna in the desert and they died. But he who believes in me will not die. That means Jesus Christ was very confident that he was going to take care of his children in this world. Whatever needs that we have in our life, he never lets us go hungry. He never lets us go hungry. In the Gospel according to St. Matthew, we talk about how Jesus came to the Jordan to be baptized by John the Baptist. After that, he was immediately led by the Holy Spirit to go to the wilderness to fast and to pray and to contend with the devil. And after that, he came back and he started to preach in the synagogues. And the very first sermon that Jesus Christ gave that was recorded in the Gospels, in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5 and 6. Jesus talked about many different things. And he said one thing to all the people. You always worry about what to eat, what to clothe for tomorrow. Your Father knows that you are in need of them. Even before you ask. Even before you ask, he knows. You don't have to ask him at all. Consider the sparrows. Consider the sparrows. They do not sow or reap or save in barns, yet your Father takes care of them. Consider the lilies of the valley. They do not yarn. They do not make yarns. They do not knit or do anything at all. Yet your Father clothes them beautifully. Even Solomon in his most glory had not been clothed like anything like the lilies of the valley. Jesus said, don't they sell 2 sparrows for 5 farthings? Not one of them shall fall without your Father's permission. He knows even the very hairs upon your head. He counts them all. This evening, we can be sure that God will take care of our needs. We don't have to worry about that at all. Don't worry about your job. He will provide you a job. If you lost a job, he will bless you with a new job. 2 days ago, I was talking to a friend of mine, and he's in the East Coast. As I was talking to him, he said, Anne, I think about my life 13 years ago. I would have never imagined I would be where I am. I'm a businessman now. I own my own business. I have employees. I am a blessing to many of the people who are working for me. I'm able to provide for my house, for my family. But you know what? 13 years ago, I was fired from my job. I came into this country as a man who was an engineer, who had a good job, good skills, great job, and I was so happy about that job. But a day came, I was sent away from my work. I thought my world was over. My wife was in tears. She did not know how we are going to make our living in this nation. She was crying. The two children did not know what to do. But I had one prayer. I asked God, I had to feed my family. Please, help me to find a job that I can feed my family. As he was praying, he also said one thing. I don't want to feed just my family, Lord. I want to be a blessing for someone in this process. Help me, Lord. And God helped him to open a press, a Minuteman press. He got a franchise. And in the middle of all the turmoil, all the problem, he was that the Minuteman press, the company themselves, they found a place for him. They moved him to a better place as well. They did all the advertisement. They gave him all the equipment. They gave him all the supplies. All he had to do was to hire two people to work for him and just run and manage the business. I can tell you, this year we published 2 Tamil books. All those books were printed in that Minuteman Press establishment. And he says that I am able to have employees working under me. I was such a blessing. But 13 years ago, we were in tears when we lost the job. But I praise God that I lost my job. That's what he said. I did not know that I had to praise God at that time, on that day when I lost my job. But if I had not lost my job, I would have never found something where I can be a blessing for others. I'd have been very content with what I was doing. Dearly beloved, let me remind you that Jesus Christ is the bread of life. He knows how to feed you. He knows how to feed others through you to make you a blessing. He's not a God who's just thinking about eternity only and not worry about this world. He's near to you, much closer than you realize that he is close to you. He's much closer than you think that you can just even touch him and feel him right now. He's so close to you. And he says, I am the bread of life. I'll take care of whatever you need for this life. George Miller was a man who was known as a man who always got things from God. He always got things from God. That was his name. He was a man of faith. He always moved by faith. He had orphanages where children were admitted, and the children were all taken care of by his ministry that he had. As an apostle of faith, he was able to do all of that in the nation of England. But not that he always had a lot of money. He was always very accounting for all the money. But there were days when he did not have money to feed the children. There was one particular morning, the people who were running the orphanage came to him and they told him that we have no breakfast. There are 50 children who are waiting on the line. The time is now to ring the bell for the breakfast. When you ring the bell, all the children are going to come say, take their seats, but we have nothing to serve them. And George Muller said that, you go ring that bell, is what he said. And he turned and went into his office. He knelt down. He told God, we don't have breakfast if you don't give. I believe that you always provide. Thank you. That's all he said. As he finished the prayer, there was a knock on the door. They opened the door. There was a man standing there. He said that I had the milk van. I am the driver of the milk van who brings milk here. My cart is broken. I cannot take it back wherever I need to go and deliver, so I want to give all the milk to the orphanage. So milk was given and served to all the children. There was another knock. There was a bread man who came. He said that he had many loaves of bread that he has been instructed to come and give and drop off in the orphanage. Right at that moment when there was a need, the bread was given, milk was given. Let me encourage you this evening. He is never late. Our God is never late. He always takes care of us at the moment of our need that we may have, regardless of what you may think it is. The Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 9 to 11, what man of you, when your son asks him a fish, gives him a stone? What man of you, when your child asks him for an egg, he'll give him a stone? If you, who are wicked, know how to give good deeds to all your children, will my Father who is in heaven not give you what you are asking for and blessings of goodness? This evening, just believe in him. He is the bread of life. He is the bread of life who satisfies every need that we have in our lives when we believe in him. Jesus revealed himself as that bread of life. Secondly, when we think about this bread, the same bread that we need for our lives, that we always long for, we work and we do so many things for, sometimes that same bread might become a trap for ourselves. You may be wondering, what am I talking about? When Jesus Christ was talking about the last days, he was telling to all the people, you know, all these disciples came and asked him, when will all these things happen? You're talking about the end of the world and the coming of the Son of Man. When will all these things happen? When will be the end of the world? And Jesus was talking about many signs. He said that you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. You will see famines. You will see nations raising up against nations in war. At that time, the sign of the Son of Man will be upon the skies. And saying all of that, he said that, be watchful that you do not forget this particular day that is arriving because of, you know what? He didn't say because of sin. Watchful that you do not sin all these great sins so that you can go and be caught up in heaven. He didn't say that. There are only two things, that can deviate a man and take him away on the day of the coming of the Lord. It is not some huge sin. Jesus said that don't make sure that you don't commit any murder so that you can be taken over there. He said that you will lose your carefulness by two things. One is excessive eating. And the second thing is the worries of this world. Peruntindiyinalum, lauhiga kavalegalinalum, ungal irudayam baramadaiyada padikum, neengal ninaiyada naalile andha naal ungal mel varada padikum, echarikkaiyirungal. It is very, if you think about that, he said that it is not that somebody is sinning and they miss the day of the Lord. It is not that. It is just that you are so careful and carefree. You're so careful in keeping yourselves all holy before God, but you are careless about the coming of the Lord. You know why? Because you're so consumed in the matters of this world. You think that this world is the final thing for you, so you're working everything for this world. You're doing everything that you need for this world. You're eating and drinking and having fun. And in that fun, you don't have time to think about God, to think about him. Because he's feeding you, you're being filled. Because you're satisfied, you are not investing to your eternal life. And that is what Jesus warned the church about. For the people who are outside of the church, people who are not in the Lord, the warning is different. Because the Lord said that judgment will start from the house of God, first of all. And that judgment will come only when the church is not careful, when the children of God are not careful, and their carefulness is taken away when they are so much preoccupied with excessive food and excessive things of this world and partying and having reviling and doing whatever you want. Jesus said, it'll happen exactly like it happened in the days of Noah. People were giving in marriage and getting married and eating and drinking and having merry until then they didn't realize that the day came. They did not realize the day came. Perhaps there were some people that leads me to believe that they knew that this day was going to come. The day that Noah was preaching about. The day when the floods are going to be upon this world. That's going to happen. They all knew. But they always thought that it is not going to happen today. Let's go to the party and come back. It is not going to happen today. Let's just go have fun and come back. That's not going to happen today. That is exactly the trick of the enemy. The enemy always will come and try to trick us with food. The same food that we need our bodies, that God knows that we need, and he provides for us carefully, without delay. The enemy will come and try to tell us, you need that food now, right now. You need that food at any cost at all. Esau was tricked by the enemy. He came from hunting. And his younger brother was making a soup. And he said that, oh, give me some of that red soup. And he said that, well, why would I give that to you? If I had to give it to you, just give me your birthright. And now Esau sold himself for that one morsel of food that was available for him at that moment. That was the trick that the enemy has. He says, this is something that you really need. Yes, God knows you need it. But are you trying to go out of your way, trying to trade what God has given to you in exchange for the food? That is where you got to be careful. Jesus said, he went into a place of banquet and all the people had come and he saw. People were always coming and choosing the best places to sit in the banquet table in the feast. And Jesus said that when you are invited by somebody to a food, be careful, just go sit in the lowest place. He always taught them when we come together. When you are invited by someone to have food, be careful about what is being served upon you on the table. If you are someone who is given to much food, be careful. Eat only a little limited. You don't need to eat all the food that is given to you. Why is Jesus talking so much about food? Although it is needed for our body, it is also a test of our self-control. Self-control is the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. That is why Jesus is saying, you must have self-control. Jesus Christ was upon the mountain, praying for 40 days and 40 nights. He was crying and praying and travailing in the presence of God. He had not eaten anything at all in 40 days and 40 nights. And then the enemy came. He did not come when Jesus was not tired. He did not come when Jesus was not hungry. He came at the moment of Jesus' hunger. And he said that, if you are the Son of God, why don't you turn these stones into bread? That is exactly how the enemy tries to come in the area of food in our lives to lead us to go astray by trading the things that we ought not to. We all need jobs. We all need salaries. We all need money to take care of ourselves. And God knows that he does. But he says one thing he wants us to all understand, that remember that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. That is what Jesus wants us to do. When Jesus said, I am the bread of life, he equates him to that word. He is the word of God who can fulfill all our desires and all our needs, even when there is no food. We rely on the source of God, the word that can create the food, that can bring that food for us. That is what Jesus was talking to the enemy, the Satan, when he came. He said, Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Do you know where Jesus was quoting this from? Jesus was saying that it is written. That means that it must have been written somewhere in the Old Testament. Where is it written? In the Old Testament. When we go back and read the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 3, that is where this particular verse is recorded. In Deuteronomy 8:3, the word of God says, God brought you into the wilderness. You know what he did? He humbled you. He allowed you to hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. So that is where the word of God is written there. Just remember that going back and thinking about the wilderness as children of Israel were coming through, they were all worried about food. They all had food that was like warm, you know, as they were making their bread and the dough and everything, they were carrying that to the wilderness. Perhaps that was enough for 3 days, 4 days. But they were going a long distance. They were going for 40 years. There was no food at all. And the Bible says, God humbled them with no food. God humbled them with no food. And then he gave them the manna to help them to understand that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. When Moses said that you shall see manna tomorrow, it was just a simple word. But when they went out that morning, they were able to find the manna because it's the word that created that manna and brought it for them. We had to be very careful. We had to know, when we know that God is going to help us, feed us, let us not replace God with food. God provides us food, but food cannot be God. Food cannot be God. Let's not keep on working only for our food for tomorrow. Let's invest in the eternity. Let's invest in the eternity. That is the word of God. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Many years later, the people of Israel still were walking in the wilderness. And many times they made mistakes and they wanted to go back to Egypt. And they were punished. They came back to the Lord. Many times it happened again. In one of them, you know, it was a temptation of the food that was about to take them back to Egypt. Not because of anything else. They had manna. But they were saying that we are so missing of all the onions and all the garlic that we used to have in Egypt. If you want to go back, let's just find another captain and go back to Egypt. That's what they said. So food, while it is needed, God provides that for us. We have to be careful to not allow to replace our focus of our life. Go back and think about your calendar, your schedule for the previous month, 2 months, 3 months. What activities have you done that is not with the focus of food or your income? What have you done to prioritize God before anything else? How many times have you said that I want to fast and give up the food because I want to bring my body into subjection? I want to walk closer with God, so I want to just give away my food and wait upon the Lord. I want to fast myself to remember those who are without food so I can bring them something. This is the time for us to stop and think. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. But he also said that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. And do you believe in that word more than you believe that food that he will provide you? God is asking us to prioritize this life, to give more preeminence to this word than the food that is available for us. Jesus said, whoever eats this food, this bread, will be hungry again. Whoever drinks this water will thirst again. But he who comes to me will not thirst or hunger. When you think about eternity, when you think about your life as a continuum going past the life that you have in this world into the life of eternity, for you to live up to that eternity, you need that word of God, not just the physical food that is available for us upon this world. God knows that we need that, and he will provide that. That is why Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Finally, a day came when Jesus made a profound statement to the disciples as they were all there. It was the day before Jesus Christ was to be crucified. It was the day of Passover. All the disciples were with Jesus. They were all thinking that we're going to have a great celebration of the Passover. We're going to remember the great mercies of God. We're going to remember how God sent his angel and he smote all the Egyptians and he brought our forefathers out of the Egypt. We're going to have that Passover. We're going to apply the blood upon all our houses, upon our doorposts. We're going to stay inside and we're going to keep our Passover. Little did they realize that they had that Passover lamb, the sacrificing lamb of Jesus Christ with them. They did not realize that. But they asked Jesus. They asked Jesus one thing. Where do you want us to prepare the Passover? Jesus said, go into the town and you will see a man who carries water upon his shoulders. Follow him. Whatever house he goes, go into that house and ask the master of the house where is the right place for us to keep the Passover, and he will show you an upper room that is already furnished. Prepare it there. They all came together in that upper room. Everyone was sitting. No one realized that next day was the day when Jesus Christ was going to be crucified. They were all sitting at the table, and at that time Jesus took the bread and he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body. This is my body. He was making a profound statement there. I am the lamb that was sacrificed, whose body you were supposed to eat. I am the lamb that was killed for you. I am the lamb that was sacrificed for you tonight. This is going to be a different Passover. This is not the same Passover that you had ritualistically held and observed for many different generations of your forefathers. This is the real thing. This is the real Passover. I am the real Lamb who have been sent to you. I want you to understand that I am the bread of life. I am the Lamb who was killed for you, and take, eat this bread. And this is my body that has been broken for you. This evening, the Lord wants us to remember that setting, that upper room where the Passover was being held, where Jesus was giving the bread to everyone. Just imagine that you were sitting on the table with him right now. When Jesus is giving a piece of bread to you, and he said, take and eat, this is my body that has been broken for you. Imagine that body. That body was beaten for your sins. That body was pierced upon the cross. That body bore many stripes with which you are healed. That body was hanging motionless upon the cross. When a soldier pierced it through to see if he was already dead. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. I am the bread of life. And he wants you to be part of him. He wants you to remember every day, every time we come together by the Holy Communion, he wants you to remember that he is the Lamb who was broken for your sins, who gave his own body for everything that you have ever done, thought of doing, missed your mark and did, or whatever it is. By his stripes, you are healed. This evening, let's all stand to our feet, asking the Lord, Lord, I want you to be the bread of life in my life today, Lord. I want you to be the bread of life, O Lord. Jeevan, jeevan ki roti main hu. Jeevan ki roti main hu. That is a statement of the Lord Jesus Christ is coming to you. Whoever is watching upon the live stream this evening, the Lord says, I am the bread of life. I was broken for you. I was pierced for you. I broke my body so that you can be healed. I took all the curses upon me. I took all your sins upon me. I shed my blood so that your sins may be washed clean. I will take care of your needs in this world. You don't have to worry about that. But don't replace me with your food. Don't replace my place for anything else. This evening, would you surrender yourself? If you've never received Jesus Christ in your life, today you can say, Lord, I want you to come into my life, that I want to have you as my master, O Father. As you are the living bread, you were broken for me upon the cross. I accept you as my personal Savior. If that is you, you just raise up your hand and say, Lord, I want you to come into my life. Perhaps you say, Lord, I received you, but I had wrong priorities in my life. I considered my own personal things of more important than the things of you, Lord. I had not been having self-control in many areas of my life. Today, I want to change my priorities. I want, with your help, O Father God, exercise self-control in every area of my life. If that is you, you raise your hand and say, Lord, I want to commit myself. Oh, Lord, bless me. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Father, we surrender ourselves, O Father God. We thank you because you are the bread of life who came into this world, O Father God, to give your own life for us. We thank you, Lord, for even reminding us this evening, O Father God, the sacrifice that you have offered for us upon the cross. Lord, I pray that your hand will be upon everyone who made a commitment today for you, O Father God. Let them, O Father God, pass over today, tonight, from darkness to light, from death to life, from emptiness to fullness, O Lord, from tears to joy, O Lord, from cursing to blessings, O Lord. Let them, O Father God, have life, a life fully abundant in their lives even now. Lord, I pray, oh Father God, for everyone who is watching from their homes on this live stream, oh Father God. We pray that your blessings will be upon them. Bless them, oh Father God. Bless every family, oh Lord. Today, oh Father God, will be a new day that we enter into a new week, oh Father God, with the grace of the Lord leading us into that week. And we thank you, Lord, for you're going to do that. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.